and sing out that song just like Judah. Amen. Let's put our hands together. Let's sing it out just like Judah.
Just like Judah, a long, long time ago, we are the instruments of praise, shouting glory to defeat the foe. Blow the trumpet, praise his holy name.
Sing out again, just like Judah.
Just like Judah, a long, long time ago,
we are
the instruments of praise. Trumpet, praise his holy name.
So let us praise.
So let us praise him. Let us praise him. Everybody praise his holy name. Let us praise him. Let us praise him. Everybody praise his holy name.
Sing it out. We are soldiers.
We are soldiers in the battlefield. We are the instruments of praise, marching onward to possess and
claiming every land.
Claiming every land in Jesus' name.
So let us praise.
So let us praise him. Everybody praise his holy name. Let us praise him. Let us praise him. Everybody praise him.
One more time, sing it out. Let us praise.
So let us praise him. Let us praise him. Everybody praise his holy name.
Amen. Let's give God praise tonight. Father, we worship. Amen. Let's put our hands together. Let's sing out that song, Most High. Sing it out. I want to see your face.
I want to see your face.
Sing it out. Sing, I want to know your power.
I want to know your power.
Oh, come fill me up.
Come fill me once again. You lift me up in your hands of praise.
Amen. Sing it out. Put a new song.
Put a new song in my mouth of praise to you, and the world will see and feel your name.
Put a new song in my mouth.
Put a new song in my mouth of praise to you, and the world will see and feel your name.
Sing it out, worthy.
Worthy.
Sing it out from the top. I want to see your face.
And I want to see your face.
Lord, I want to know.
I want to know your ways.
Oh,
let your light shine upon us.
Amen. Church, sing it out. I want to know your power.
to know your power.
Oh, come fill me up.
Come fill me once again.
Oh, you lift me up. You lift me up
in your hands of grace.
Amen. Let's sing it out, church. Put a new song in my mouth.
Put a new song in my mouth of praise to you, and the world will see and fear your name. Put a new song in my mouth of praise to you, and the world will see and fear your name.
Sing it out, you are worthy.
Worthy.
Let's worship the King of Kings tonight. Father, we magnify you. We thank you, God. Amen. Let's lift our hands in this place tonight. Let's sing out that song, When Mountains Fall.
You make your face to shine on me, that my soul knows.
Above all names, God, we worship you. Have your way, God. Have your way, have your way, God. We worship you, God. We worship you, King. Yes, God, we thank you, God. We worship you, God. We exalt you, God. We worship you in this place. Amen. I feel the presence of God. How many's excited to be in the presence of God? Amen. Tonight. Amen. We welcome everyone out. Amen. To the Door Church. Amen. This evening for our Wednesday night refill. How many need a refill? I don't know about you. Amen. I had a long week. Amen. But it's good to cut the week in half. Amen. Come and worship the living King tonight. Amen. Let's go before God in prayer tonight. Obviously, salvation for unsaved loved ones, those that are unsaved, unsaved family members, prodigal sons and daughters. Amen. Romero family. Flores family, Metzger, Martinez, James, Gutierrez, and Adjoina families, amen. Also for those for healing tonight, amen. Jamie Frank, there's a growth in the stomach surgery next Thursday, so believe God for that. But how many in this place tonight, amen, you have a prayer? Amen. You have prayers. How many know we all have needs? Amen. This is a church. Amen. And where there's a church, amen, there are going to be needs. Amen. But how many know we serve a faithful God? God, he'll meet every need. He's faithful to answer prayer tonight. So believe God for that. Amen. Also, our missionaries. Let's not forget our missionaries. Who are we praying tonight? Pastor Tori Williams. Amen. He's excited to come back for conference. I actually just talked to him last week. He's super fired up for conference. Amen. Also, those serving in the military, law enforcement. Amen. Our first responders, as well as a special prayer for Veronica Sam. Also, Jackie Jones had a stroke. Amen. Needs a miracle. Amen. So let's believe God for Jackie Jones. Also, the prison ministries. Amen. So let's go before God in prayer tonight. Amen. And as we go ahead and open up, we'll have Brother Gordon open us in prayer tonight. Father God, we thank you, God, for your grace, mercy in this place tonight. God, we ask that you would meet every need, God, for you know the end from the beginning. God, we trust that you would touch those sick in body. We cast out infirmity. We bind every demonic stronghold. God, have your way in this service tonight.
Yes, Father God, we come before you, Lord, by your grace, Lord, and by your mercy. God, we believe in you, Lord, for a miracle. Lord, have your way in this service. God, I pray, stir us, Lord, touch our hearts, God, our minds. God, I pray for healing, Lord, for unsafe family, Lord. I pray for deliverance, Lord, the backslidden, God, the brokenhearted. God, save our nation, God. God, I pray for Pastor Williams, Lord, revive in the nation of Barbados. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Let's give God praise tonight. Amen. Amen. So you guys may be seated. Amen. Again, we welcome everyone out, those visiting with us to the Door Church for our Wednesday night service. Amen. Let's give God praise as Brother Angel comes tonight. Amen.
Amen. Just a couple of announcements for us here. Tomorrow night, we do have our Spanish service. That's going to be held here in our main sanctuary. That'll be starting at 7:30 p.m. We do have a prayer for our Spanish service an hour before there in the fellowship hall. That'll be at 6:30. All those involved in the Hamilton play, we are going to be meeting right here at the altar immediately after service. The vans do leave tomorrow at 7 p.m. If you would keep us in prayer, we are going to take that play to Colleen. Amen for Pastor James Rosario. The very excited for that. Amen. Believing God for fruit there. This Friday, we do have our Crossfire Youth Ministry that's held at our 180 building, 399 South Washington Street. Prayer for that starts at 6:30 p.m. This Saturday morning, we do have our outreach at 9:30 a.m. Outreach at 10 a.m. with prayer at 9:30 a.m. The concert starts at 7:30. We do have prayer at 6:30, and then we do have set up at 5:30. And just a couple of dates to keep in mind. Next weekend, September 11th, we are having a first responder theme 180 that's going to be ran by our children's church. We do have flyers that are going to be on the way for that. Amen. Invite any first responders, officers, ex-military that you know. They are going to get a free Eric Cook biscuit. Amen. He's going to be doing some brisket for that night. Not biscuit, brisket. Amen. They probably won't come for biscuits, but they'll come for brisket. Amen. And then September 11th, that morning as well, all the men, we are doing the mass cleaning here for the church in preparation for conference. That'll be at 7 a.m. And then the following weekend, all the ladies are going to be cleaning the interior. That's Saturday the 18th, and that'll be at 9 a.m. If you have any questions about that, please see myself for the men. Please see Miss Carol, all the ladies there. And then we do have our conference September 27th through October 1st. Amen. That's all the announcements I have for you. God bless you. Amen. I'm still up here. Glory to God. Pastor Campbell asked me to take the offering tonight. Amen. I count it a privilege. Amen. I appreciate the opportunity. How many came ready to give on a Wednesday night? Amen. How many believe that Christianity, like our pastor says, is a religion of power? Amen. It's a religion where God has given us authority from heaven right from the beginning. Genesis 1:28, speaking to Adam and Eve, God blessed them and God said to them, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air and over every living thing that moves. So God, he's given us power. So what I want you to ask yourself in this offering, why are there Christians that live their Christianity out, live their life out with no dominion, no power, and no authority. And many times this plays out, especially in the arena of finances. Amen. We have to understand that the kingdom of God that you and I are involved in or supposed to be functioning in, that kingdom has principles. Amen. When those principles or those guidelines that God has given us are violated, amen, God is not able to reach outside those laws that he established. Amen. That would make God a liar. Amen. How many know God's not going to go against his word? In Malachi 3:8, we see what happens when this very thing plays out. The principle of the tithe and the offering is violated. The product of this violation is, number one, God is not able to bless. And number two, a cursing comes upon your house. Verse 8 of Malachi chapter 3. Will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. But you say, in what way? And he says, in tithes and in offerings. Verse 9. You are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation. So not only do you withhold the blessing of God from your life when you violate the tithe and the offering, but you also release a curse upon your household. So now we know what happens when we violate the tithe and the offering. But on the flip side, if we choose by faith to obey God and to do what God asks us, amen, the power of God that he released in the book of Genesis, the power of God that he gave to us, that's our right, it's our authority, amen, is now activated in our lives. God is able to get behind a decision, because that's what it is, an offering and a tithe. It's a decision that we have to make. He's able to get behind that. He's able to work on our behalf. Amen. In Malachi chapter 3, the very next verse, chapter 10, right off the bat, God tells us exactly what he expects from us. Amen. He gives us clear directions. He tells us what he wants us to do. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse that there may be food in my house. And then he calls us right after that to an act of faith. This is God calling us out. Try me in this, is what he said. He puts himself on a limb. He says, he challenges you and I to believe. Amen. And right there is where the rubber meets the road. Amen. That's exactly what's about to happen. You're about to be challenged. A plate is going to be passed right in front of you, and you're going to have to make a decision to obey the principle or to disobey. Amen. But look what happens when we choose to take God at his word by faith. Amen. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, let there may be food in my house. Try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open. Amen. That's the power of God that's activated there because we obey. And I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such a blessing. Down to verse 11. And I will rebuke the devourer. Amen. That's the power of God that's released from heaven when me and you choose by faith, amen, to simply obey what God has already told us to do. I mean, it's very, very simple. But if you don't understand these kingdom principles, this is where people start saying crazy stuff like, you know, that's why I don't go to church, man. All they want is my money. How many of you said that before you were saved? I know I said that. The funny thing is most of the people that say that are broke. I was broke when I used to say it. Amen. God does not want our money. He's after our heart. Amen. He's after our faith. Amen. And I know most of you have been faithful before I was even born. Amen. You understood this revelation. A lot of you in here have been giving faithfully. We appreciate that. We got conference coming up. I encourage you to pray. Amen. To believe God. Amen. For miracle money. I know Pastor has a lot of plans that he wants to do, nations and cities on his heart. Let's partner with our pastor. Amen. Maybe you're new in this place. You don't know what a tithe is. You've never tithed. You haven't started tithing. Amen. I encourage you, take God at his word. Amen. And and he'll get behind you. The power of God is accessible to you. All you have to do is obey. A tithe is simply 10% of your gross income that automatically belongs to God. Anything above that is your offering. Amen. If the ushers can make their way forward, we have many ways to give. If you're writing a check tonight, make it out to the door. If you need a record of cash giving, we do have offering and tithe envelopes for that. We do have these debit card slips available as well. You can also give online at tdc.church. Click on the give button and you'll be redirected, amen, to the appropriate page. If I can have my brother Gilbert, if you can pray for the offering.
God is great and greatly to be praised. Glory, glory to his name. God is great and greatly to be praised. Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
I will bow.
Before his majesty.
Musicians, thank you for your ministry tonight. Praise God. Amen. If you haven't figured it out already, I'm preaching this evening. Amen. If you'll turn in your Bibles, Romans chapter 8. Romans 8, that's in the New Testament for those of you that never read your Bible. Romans chapter 8, such a great joy to be here, such a privilege. To be allowed to come and stand behind Pastor Campbell's desk, amen, his sacred pulpit, amen, and to minister, amen. And you guys are the world's easiest congregation to preach to, amen. And so I count myself just blessed, amen, being able to minister. I want to say something. I want to get something clear. I want to kind of clear the air on something. Pastor Campbell made a statement the other day, and he was talking about, can you take a no? You know, how do you react when you're told no? And he brought up the woman's dress and the man's 9mm. Okay, I want to make something clear, okay? When a man is breaking into your house at 2:00 in the morning, what are you going to do? Shake your new dress at him and go, I got a new dress. Okay, no, this is where the 9mm is. It's okay. And so let's, you know, praise God. Amen. And I know I'm probably going to hear it from half the women in the place this evening, but well, praise God. A young man by the name of Roy Benavidez was born and raised in rural South Texas. And in 1963, he enlisted in the military, in the Army specifically, and he tried out for the Green Berets and was accepted. And Roy was deployed to Vietnam in 1964 as one of the first contingents of Special Forces, Green Berets. If you know anything about them, their specialty is they work and train indigenous people of that land and train them to be guerrilla fighters. And in 1964, Roy, while on a patrol, stepped on a landmine and shredded his leg as the thing exploded. He was immediately knocked unconscious. When he came to a month later, he's in Bethesda Naval Hospital in just outside of Washington. His memory was wiped clean. He has no memory of the event, but he is looking at the doctors, and the doctors are telling him, "You're never going to walk again. Your leg is mangled. It's beyond repair, and you're never going to walk again." And so he was of a stubborn nature. So at night when the staff, you know, the nurses would be in the nurses' station and the doctors went home, at night he would lower himself off the bed and he'd crawl to a railing on the side of the hospital room, pull himself up, and practice standing. Once he was able to stand, he practiced shuffling his feet. And little by little, over the course of the year, he literally regained his ability to walk and to run. So much so that they offered him a discharge and he turned it down and he says, no, the Army is my home and I don't want to go anywhere. And so they said, okay, they tested him and they found him fit for duty. So they asked him, where do you want to go? And he says, honestly, I never finished my tour in Vietnam. I want to go back. And so he volunteers to go back to South Vietnam. So now he goes there in 1967. Now in 1968, May of 68 to be exact, he's at the home base and a frantic radio call comes over the radio waves as a captain of a patrol, a 12-man Green Beret team, has been ambushed. They were training and patrolling with local Montagnard Indians, or not Indians, but natives. They were basically the hillbillies of Vietnam. They would train the Montagnards because they were excellent night fighters. They walked into an ambush of 1,000, a combination of North Vietnamese and Viet Cong soldiers. 12 men and 100 Montagnards are completely surrounded. Men are dying left and right. Every member of the 12-man Special Forces team has been wounded. And the captain's on the radio screaming for help. He says, we've desperately, desperately need help. So men start running to helicopters. Roy, his rifle is in his hooch, grabs the nearest thing he's got, a medic's bag and his knife, and he runs and jumps into the nearest helicopter and they take off. As they're approaching the landing zone, one of the helicopters is blown out of the sky. The second one they're in takes fire and they do what's called a hard landing. And so as he spills out with the other men trying to get to these wounded Americans and Montagnards, he's hit in the leg by a bullet. He keeps running and he begins to start dragging soldiers back to the helicopter. While he's dragging the second soldier, he's shot in the back. At the same time, somebody throws what's called a Chaicom, a Chinese communist grenade. It simultaneously explodes, and he's hit not only by a bullet in the back, now he's hit with grenade shrapnel. He's knocked unconscious again. When he regains consciousness, he runs. He grabs a radio and starts directing airstrikes to protect him and the others. So now the helicopters are now coming back now to start picking these men up. The first rescue helicopter is shot down. The crew is killed. Second helicopter lands as he's carrying a wounded soldier. He's bayoneted in the back by a North Vietnamese soldier. And not having his weapon, he grabs the man and pulls out his knife and stabs him to death. Picks up the wounded man again and proceeds on to the helicopter. One of the bullets that had hit him, because he's now hit, by the way, two more times, but one of the bullets that hit him crossed him sideways, opening his abdomen. He throws the wounded soldier into the helicopter. He climbs in himself, and immediately his intestines spill out onto the helicopter floor. He passes out again. When he awakes, he's unable to open his eyes because there's so much blood on his face that it has caked over and dried on his eyes. He's so wounded, he's unable to move his limbs. And his body is so traumatized, he's unable to speak as he hears the doctor say, there's nothing we can do for him. He's dead. And they begin to zip up the body bag. So he sums up all the strength that he can and spits a loogie and hits the doctor in the face. The doctor, realizing he's alive, takes a closer look and says, I think he's going to make it. Staff Sergeant Roy Benavidez won the Congressional Medal of Honor. I think that's the least they could have done for him. Okay, so you're probably going, my God, where's he going with this? The reality of the Christian life is that it is a life of warfare. If you don't have to be saved very long to understand, it's heaven and hell, it's good and evil, it's light and darkness, doing battle. And so if this is true, then listen to me carefully, because this is where I'm going. If the Christian life is a battle, then you better learn how to fight wounded. Romans chapter 8, let's look at a man that was greatly wounded, but knew how to live for God, and now he's giving words of hope and faith to a church that is suffering horrible persecution in Rome. In verse number 35, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height or depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Fighting wounded. So let's talk first of all about the reality of the battle. You know, when I was young, I grew up on war flicks. I got to be honest, you know, I grew up on John Wayne years ago in Tennessee. You know, I was talking about John Wayne, and the congregation went, who? And I thought, this ain't right, man. This ain't right, you know. And John Wayne, I grew up on John Wayne movies, and you know, these war flicks where they almost glamorized war. They romanticized war, you know, the war hero movies, and they'd come to the rescue in the last moment and great victories. But the reality of war is people get wounded. The reality of war is people get maimed. People get killed. In pastoring for 12 years in Clarksville, Fort Campbell right there, it was common. After a while, you don't even pay attention. It was common to walk into Walmart and have a man standing behind a counter or something. You know, he's looking for merchandise, and then to have him walk around the corner and he's got no legs. Or somebody that's doing something one-handed, because as he turns the other way, you realize the man's missing an arm. Or someone's been disfigured permanently, because this is the reality of war. And the kingdom of God is no different. You know, we love to give victory reports. You know, we love when an outreach just worked. We love, you know, as a pastor in conference time, oh, we love it when they you know, you're checking in and they go, hey, you're on the schedule. You're giving a report Wednesday night. And you're like, praise God. It's been a wonderful year, man. And shoot, our church has doubled. We got money. We're sending impact. It's wonderful. But, you know, I've also had those conferences where I didn't quite walk through the door. I just kind of dripped underneath the door. You know, and they go, hey, they want you to give a report Tuesday night. And I'm like, oh. Pastor Campbell has a joke that he would say, you know, he goes, there's less pressure preaching in a conference than giving a report at a conference. And I go, how can that be? And he says, you don't have to lie when you preach. You know, and there's reality that you know, we're getting ready to, you know, in a few weeks, conference time is coming. There's going to be people, and the reality of it is that some are going to be wounded, that it's been a bad year, that there's times that hell is connected, amen. There's going to be times that you know, we have an outreach or we had an encounter. We know we had a demonic situation in our lives where we know hell threw something at us. And praise God, the shield of faith and the sword of God and all that. And we're able to give a victory report. But you know what, though? There's going to be times when you're limping away. You've had an encounter, and it's the devil that's raising his hands, and you're walking away limping, going, what just happened there? What just took place here? And the reality is, he won, hell won, and you've been wounded. And sometimes it could be just the pain of life. The pain of life is inescapable. Amen. And so are the wounds of warfare. There are different types of assaults that the enemy will throw at you. And because of those different assaults, there will be different types of wounds. Pastor Campbell, I think it was a couple, maybe 3 weeks ago, Pastor Campbell preached that sermon about head wounds. And he made a mention about that. He used the term, we all know, nervous breakdown. That there's times I've dealt with people where mentally they have collapsed. They can't function. They don't know what to do. They're looking at you with these mannequin eyes going. They can't even speak properly. You know, to try to describe exactly what they're going through. Could be a physical attack, could be your health, could be issue of sickness. James Martinez, you know, here's this, you know, James Martinez. He's, you know, you ever read his testimony? How that guy got delivered. But he's the only guy in our fellowship and he's been delivered and relivered. I'm like, that's pretty cool. Wow, relivered. But here's a guy that through the cancer and all that still continued to fight. Bridget Meyer dealing with her cancer issues. And yet here they are still faithful to the things of God, still faithful to the call of God. Sometimes the attack can be people. It can be violations. Remember, even Jesus said this. He goes, it's impossible. It's impossible for offenses not to come. He goes, as long as you're living in a world that has human beings, somewhere you're going to be offended. Somewhere you're going to be violated. He goes, it's impossible. Sometimes it could be the circumstances of life that has struck a blow. It could be the setbacks of life, what I call the curveballs of life, man. How many played baseball? I couldn't hit with her darn. You know, whenever I got up to the plate, I just swang because I just don't have that split second vision. You know what I mean? It's like some guys, they're able to slow the ball in their mind, you know, as it's coming home plate. Me, I just, it was almost like closing my eyes and swing. When I hit it, now I got to say, when I hit it, but I struck out 3/4 of the time. And the curveball. When you threw a curveball at me, it was utter confusion. Listen to me. There's going to be times that life is going to throw you a curveball. You were sure you were going to get a hit. You were positive this was going to work. You were positive, man, this is the will of God. And you struck out. And you're walking away from the plate going, what just happened there? Even Jesus experienced this. John chapter 6, verse 66. This has always freaked me out. John 6, 66. It says, and from that time on, many of the disciples turned back and followed Jesus no more. Now, key word right there, disciples. We're not talking the Klingons. We're not talking about the groupies, remember, that are just following him so they could check out the miracles and maybe he's going to make some food and get free lunch again. We're not talking those guys. The key word there is disciples. Jesus has poured his life into these men. He's invested in these men. These men are dedicated. And there came a point, man, suddenly he's going, unless you, you know, drink my blood and eat my flesh, you have no part of me. And they're like, yeah, hey, wait a minute. Hold on. And they turn away and it says many of them. The moment is so heavy that Jesus himself even looks at the 12 and goes, will you go also? Because the reality of wounds is they're personal. Isaiah 54, verse 17. You know, we love quoting the scripture, no weapon formed against you shall prosper. You know, that's great. But that's telling us, one, there's an enemy somewhere. And two, he's got weaponry. And three, it's aimed at you. And he says, no weapon formed against you shall prosper. That word formed in the Hebrew literally means handmade, custom made. That in other words, that the enemy, that the devil has weapons custom made, handmade for you, your personality, your situation, your marriage, your family, that these things are custom made for you. Not only are they custom made, but hell's attacks are timed and they're strategic. So let's talk secondly about the danger of getting wounded. You hear a term now and then. You know, if you've been around for any length of time, you'll hear a term where somebody says he never recovered from his wounds. Or you read a story of there's been a tragic assault of some type, you know, and a shooting or whatever it might be. And they say he was rushed to the hospital. But then they say what? He died of his wounds. He didn't recover from his wounds. You know, if you've been in the church, you've heard Pastor Campbell say many times, life is 10% what happens to you, but it is 90% how you respond, how you process what has just happened. That a crisis, but 10%. That the reality is, what's going to be the make or break in this is how you process this thing. And this is so powerfully too when it comes to regarding wounds, when you've been wounded. A wound, if I can say it in another way, is 10%. But how you respond to that wound is 90% of the equation. And people react differently when they're wounded. Some people run away. Some people, you've heard stories in the military, you know, where they abandon their post. They panicked, sheer terror gripped them. They've been shot or whatever it might be. And they leave. As a pastor, how many times through the years have I heard someone come up to me and they've been hit. Life has struck a blow. Life has thrown a curveball. Something went wrong, whatever the circumstance might be. And I have them come to me and they say, Pastor, I'm not going to be coming to church for a while. I need to get my head together. And I always say famous last words. Famous last words. I've never, in almost 40 years of preaching, I have never, anybody that quits coming to church and says, I need to get my head together, has never come back. Because you don't get your head together out there. You get your head together in the hospital. You come to the ER, man. If you're wounded, come to the hospital and get put back together again. Sometimes the wounds are self-inflicted. I'm talking about sin issues, where it wasn't life. It was just simply a self-inflicted sin wound, a sin issue, unrepented sin, undealt with sin. And now the problem is now you have fallen into condemnation. You have fallen into guilt and shame. And so what do? They stop coming to church. How many have ever had people, you're working with them, and you know they're struggling with something, and you know they have fallen, you know they went out and did something stupid, and now they're totally off the grid. People ask you, whatever happened to so-and-so? Well, I've seen people backslide because of a wound. Think of the book of Ruth. Here's Ruth and Orpah. That here they are. They have both been dealt the same blow. They've both been wounded in the same way. But Orpah, Bible says, turned back. Went back home. In other words, she ran away. She quit because of the wound. She came to a point, I can't do this anymore. And she turns back and she's never heard from again. Bible says John Mark fled. Another danger with being wounded is becoming bitter. Again, the term, he never recovered from his wounds. Sometimes the danger with a wound is that it can become infected. And the infection kills the person, not the initial wound. That the wound actually began to heal to a certain extent, but the infection spread through the body and killed him. What Satan is hoping for is the infection of bitterness sets in and it ultimately kills you. Sometimes from a wound that occurred years ago. I know people. I've pastored people that things went wrong. They took a hit. Okay, they were wounded. Okay. And infection of bitterness sets in. And years later, they've not recovered from it. It's still, whenever you talk to them, that infection comes up. I was wounded. I was wounded years ago. How many have ever talked to someone on an outreach? You know, you knock on the door and you go, hi, hey, I'm from the door. Just want to tell you about Jesus. And you're like, oh, here we go. Don't tell me about you. 1955. And they start spewing on you about some of it. And I swore I'll never step foot in a church again because in 1955, you know what's happening? They've never recovered from some wound. And the wound could have been from their pastor. Bible says, faithful are the wounds of a friend. It could have been from a pastor inflicting the wound of correction. Or like Pastor was saying no to your plans. And they've never recovered. Because the issue is, can you still serve God even when you've been hit? Can you still serve God and not develop a foul attitude when you've been wounded? Because can I say something about Staff Sergeant Benavidez? He's multiple wounded, but he kept rescuing souls, even with his own wounds. And let me say right here, many times, bitterness is linked to a weird mentality that people can have sometimes. And that is that we expect God to explain himself when something happens. when we've been struck a blow, we've been wounded, there is something quirky about the human personality that is like, oh, God, this went horrible wrong. Oh, this setback, this crisis, this wound, this curveball, whatever it is. God, why? Why? Explain thyself. Jeremiah, you know, does the clay demand of the potter, why have you done this? And he's making a point. He goes, God's going to do what God's going to do. It's not his responsibility to explain everything to us. In fact, can I throw something at you? Can we talk? You'll drive yourself crazy asking God why and expecting an answer. There's going to be times when he's trying to make the point here is, I'm not going to explain myself. Somewhere you've got to trust me. Job, do you trust me? Okay, there I said it. 2 Corinthians chapter 12. This is the famous scripture. Remember, this is the chapter that Paul the Apostle, here he is, man. This dude, you know, the Lord takes him to see the third heaven. I saw the third heaven, and I was told I'm never allowed to reveal what I saw. I can't even wrap my mind around that. The third heaven. I'll be happy just to get to the first one, man. Listen, I don't care if I'm riding coach. I'm in heaven. It's okay. It's all right. You know, and this guy, he's been to the third one, but here's this guy. Here's this heavyweight of faith, a thorn in the flesh. And scholars, they're kind of tossed. They're not just, some believe he had epilepsy, the fall down disease. Some believe that it was the persecution, the incredible, over-the-top persecution, a dimension of persecution that this guy went through. And others believe, no, man, it was a demon. It was a flat-out demon that was assigned by Satan himself to go after Paul and to torment him. We don't know what it is, but whatever it is, here is this man of faith, man, this major leaguer. Praise Lord, take it away. Take it away. And the Lord goes, nope. No. Three times petitioning God. No, I'm not going to do that. He says, you're stronger. You know what he's saying? He says, Paul, you're stronger than you think. He says, my grace, you don't need a miracle of me taking this thing away. My grace, all I've got to do is give you a dimension of grace, man, and watch what that grace does during your trial, during your crisis. And he doesn't explain himself to Paul. Why is that? Because Paul knew how to fight wounded. You ever read his testimony? Next time you're complaining, you know, next time you find yourself, you know, like, I got it so hard, you know. And you know, 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 24, from the Jews, five times, I received 40 stripes minus one. Now, so he's saying 39 stripes, okay? Why is he saying that? Because they believed 40 stripes will kill a man. It'll kill a man. You hit him 40 times, and so what they would do, it was basically a death sentence, so they said, well, don't sentence him to death, just whip him 39 times. So five times. You know, he's been beaten with rods three times. Once I was stoned, three times shipwrecked. A night and a day I've been in the deep. Journeys often, in peril of water, in peril of robbers, in peril of my own countrymen. On and on and on. And this thing just goes on. We know this story. History tells us he was beaten with rods so severely that his spine is going to develop a curvature. This is one of the reasons that the Corinthians said his appearance is despicable. because here's this preacher walking around hunched over because his spine was permanently deformed. And you never hear of him complaining. Would you? Paul and Silas in prison, beaten, feet in stocks, cold, damp prison. And somebody says, let's praise God. Let's sing songs of worship and praise God. Would you? I ask myself, would I? I mean, I've put myself in that situation. And, you know, and we all like to go, oh, my faith. Oh, it would shine forth like the noonday sun from that. Yeah. I've seen folks backslide, you know, just because an outreach didn't go their way. And I don't mean literally backslide, but you know what I mean. Another danger with wounds is that you begin to start thinking, God is mad at me. You start thinking to yourself, God's punishing me. God doesn't like me. And you can develop a twisted, weird attitude from a wound. Naomi. Here's Naomi, man. Her friends see her, you know. I mean, you know, it says the ladies of Bethlehem, when they saw her, oh, they're running to her. You know, they're probably like, oh, Naomi. Oh, hey, girlfriend, where you been? You know, and don't call me Naomi. Call me Mara. I went out full, but God brought me back empty. And the girls are probably going, okay. We'll catch you later. We'll talk to you later. In the course of the years, you know, you do marriages. And I've got to be honest here. How long have I been preaching here? Rats. Every time, man. You guys are like magnets. You guys are like sermon magnets. Well, I've got nowhere to go. I've got nowhere to go. I'm going home to leftover chicken pot pie. Okay. I'm in no hurry to go home. Well, yeah, I got all night. Okay. All right. But I do, you know, you do weddings and stuff. You'll marry people. And so, you know, you're up there, you know, and obviously I'm not downplaying. It's a big event for them, you know, and stuff. But, you know, I'll be standing there with, you know, with my Bible, you know, and I got my wedding notes and I'm standing there, you know, dearly beloved. We are gathered here in the sight before God and these witnesses to join together Myron Crumby and Agatha Brickrock. And you're standing there, you're going through the whole ceremony, you know, and you're standing there looking all holy and spiritual, you know. And I love it when I'm reading through the things and I'm looking at them and, you know, and it's always great. You know, like I said, I'm not downplaying their love for one another, but, you know, you'll see these people. I'm like, okay, take, you know, Myron, take Agatha's hand and they repeat after me. And so they'll be looking at each other and, you know, they're going, you know, and then he looks back. And people ask me, Pastor, what are you thinking of during that time? Half the time I'm up there going, I wonder what Colleen made for lunch. Sorry. I say, you're getting married, not me. You know. But the part where you pay attention is where you say, take each other's hand. And you say, do you, Myron Crumby, take Agatha Brickrock to be your lawfully wedded wife? And then what do you say? In sickness and in health, for better, for worse, right? And what's the other one?
Come on.
Okay, good. Someone's paying attention. All right. For richer, and for poorer. Okay. And that's the part where you're paying attention and I'm paying attention and I'm looking at their eyes going, this is real. What you're about to do here is real. For better, for worse, richer, poorer, sickness, and in health. You know what you're saying? You're vowing to one another, even if we're hit, even if we're wounded, I will never leave you. I will never leave you. If our money gets wounded, if our health gets wounded. My wife, when I met my wife, she was a spunky, spry little 15-year-old. Okay, relax. I could relax. I was 17. Okay, that's all right. So just relax. People are going, I was 17. We met in high school. Okay, relax. All right. And she was that spry 15-year-old prancing and jumping around and running up and down the Oceanside Beach. And I want to say I was a young, spunky, spry 17-year-old, you know, and, went to the beach myself and stuff. But you know what? Those 44 years of marriage, I've also had my health hit. 2 heart attacks, a tumor, and a quadruple bypass. And when I've woke up from the quadruple, and they have your hands tied to the bed because you're intubated, and your first reaction is you want to pull it out of your throat, and obviously you can't do that. So I've and I've come out of that drug-induced stupor from the surgery, and I open my eyes, and she's the first person I see. That she's been right there through my heart attacks. She's been right there when life has dealt a blow. She's been there when I stepped on a landmine and blew a leg off. And that's what the vows are all about. I need to move quickly here. I need to close. I'm going to close. Let's talk finally about the revelation of God. There's a dimension of God that is only revealed when you've been wounded. And this is the reality of life. That there is a part of God that he goes, no, 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 no. You're God, I want to know you. I want to know you. We sing the song, I want to know you more. And all these, and Paul said, that I may know him in the fellowship of his suffering. I mean, you're like, holy cow, dude. Why is, because there is a dimension of God that God goes, no, I only reveal this to people that have been wounded. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, again, remember the thorn. He says, no, I'm not going to take it. But Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. All you need, Paul, is a dose of my grace and the revelation of this in this wound, this hit that Paul is having to live with, okay? Lifelong, we have to assume, because there's no word that he was ever set free from it. But here he writes and he says, in my weakness, I was made strong. That in this hit, I experienced a dimension of God. I would have not any other way. Paul and Silas in prison, they've been hit, man. And yet here they're like, hey, complaining isn't going to get us out of the stocks. Might as well praise God and worship God. And next thing you know, an earthquake and a jailer and his family are getting saved, and the church in Philippi is born. Joseph. Oh, let's talk about Joseph for a moment. You meant it for evil. God meant it for good that 21 years later, he's able to sit there and go, ha, ha. When his brothers come in and they bow down before him, remember, they don't know who he is. And they bow down. Suddenly the dream, he kicks up in the throne and he's, ha, oh, the dreams, the dreams. This is it. Everything, all this that's taken place was for this moment right here. You meant it for evil. You wounded me for evil. God did it for good to save many people. Orpah quit and ran away. But here's her sister-in-law. Same wound, same hit, same blow. Orpah's running away, going, no more of this. And Ruth, with tears running down her face, points at Naomi and goes, your God shall be my God. Where they bury you, they're going to bury me. I'm not leaving anywhere. Naomi, when you die, you might as well dig two graves because I'm going to be buried next to you. And God goes, I love this girl. And then you know the story about Boaz. I won't go there. You know the. But think about this. Think about Naomi. Here's Ruth. She has, you know, her baby. She's sitting there. And what does she do? She takes the baby and gives it to Naomi. Naomi is holding King David's great-grandpa. That here she is, the revelation of God, Ruth, Naomi. What God is saying, Naomi, Ruth, I had to wound you in Moab. If I hadn't wounded you, you would have never gone back to Bethlehem and walked into the timing of God. Are you grasping this? All things work to the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose. Hosea 6:1 says, it says, he has struck us, but he will heal us. He has bruised us, but he will bind up our wounds. That there's times where God is going to allow a hit. He's going to allow hell to connect. He's going to allow life to hit you, throw you a curveball. Joseph, I know you may not understand this right now, son, but if they don't wound you, you'll never be sitting on the throne in Egypt when Israel needs help. There's people here, you've been struck. There's people here, you've been wounded, and hell would love nothing better than you get all twisted and bent and out of shape. Because and I'll be the first to admit that there's times where, yes, I've been wounded, and all I do is talk about the wound and talk about the wound. And a year later, I'm still talking about the wound, and I'm bitter about the wound, and whatever it might be. And there's times the Holy Ghost has said, all right, enough, I get it. I get it. You've been wounded. Get on with life. Rescue people. Put the wound aside and get on with serving God and watch what I do from that wound. Let's bow our heads this evening. I have gone much too long, as I always do, preaching to you. This evening, it would be a horrible, horrible miscarriage to sit here and talk about the love of Christ and the power of God to help and to heal and to bind up wounds and I give you an opportunity to get to know Jesus. Back in 1977, my wife and I was in the military. I was standing guard. I had guard duty that night. I was in the security police. George Rose came, middle of the night, in the most ugly Ford van you have ever seen. And he began to witness to me, tell me about Jesus. And I was Catholic. I couldn't quite grasp what he was talking about, but he kept witnessing to me. And little by little, he's given me tracts. And, you know, I'd try to put on a big macho show. You know, I'd throw him in the trash can. He'd give me a track. I'd throw in the trash can. And he'd drive away. And as soon as his taillights disappeared into the darkness, I'd reach into the trash bin and pull out the track and read it. And I finally ended up coming to church one night. They were showing the cross and the switchblade. And I gave my heart to Jesus that night. And I wish I could say that my life has been just a stellar Christian walk since then. And I'll be honest, for the first 3 years, I was a mess. I was not. If I was saved, it was by the grace of God. That's all I can say. 1980, I got serious, quit playing games with God. My life's never been the same. Greatest joy that I have is to tell people that Jesus can change their lives. He can wash your sins away. You're here this evening. You're living under the guilt, under the shame, under the weight of sin, a life of sin. And this evening, only the sinless blood of Jesus can wash away our sinfulness. You're here this evening. You'd say, Pastor Alvarez, I am. I'm living a life of sin. I'm sick of it. I'm tired of it. I do not want to go on like this anymore. I'm sick of it. I need forgiveness. I need peace of mind. You're here tonight and heads are bowed, eyes are closed. You would lift your hand up. I don't know everybody here, but you're here this evening and you'd say, Pastor Alvarez, will you say a prayer for me this evening? I want to get saved tonight. I want to give my life to Christ. Or you're backslidden. You're backslidden. Very honestly, you'd say, you know, I'm here, I'm in the presence of God, I'm in the presence of God's people, but my heart is not right with God at this moment. I need God to redeem me. I need Jesus to wash my sins away. I want to rededicate my heart to the Lord. You lift your hand quickly, quickly, before we go on to other things. You're here tonight. You're a visitor. You've never been saved. Jesus said, unless a man or woman is born again, you will not, they will not, you'll not see the kingdom of God. You'll not see it, let alone walk into heaven. You're here and you'd say, Pastor, I want to give my heart to the Lord. Anybody at all, quickly. This evening, tonight, as we open up this altar, let's all stand together. I do again apologize. I know I went long, but I do want to open up this altar. Are you reeling from a wound? Have you been wounded? Maybe in your prayers, do you find yourself over? Why, God? Why? I don't understand. Where does this fit? Where does this piece of the puzzle possibly fit? This wound, how does it make sense? Maybe you've become bitter. Maybe tonight, you'd be honest, you're dealing with bitterness. You were wounded years ago, and years later, the infection of bitterness is what's killing you. Amen.
You make your face to shine on me, that my soul knows very well. You lift me up, I'm cleansed and free, that my soul knows very well. When mountains fall, I stand by the power of your hand, and in your heart of hearts I dwell. That my soul knows very well.
joy and strength. Each day I find that my soul knows very
tonight. Let's give the Lord praise tonight. Oh, we thank you, Jesus. God, we give you glory this evening. Praise you tonight. Praise and glory. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you so much for your attentiveness tonight. Amen. So I with you, you're my test group. I know, okay, I need to go from 4 pages to 3. To get this thing down. Amen. But thank you so much for your attention tonight. Amen. I hope the sermon helped some folks this evening. Let's give God praise as Pastor comes tonight.
Amen. Powerful message tonight. Amen. How many had a good time tonight? Amen. Powerful message tonight. Amen. Just remember all the activities, amen, throughout the rest of this week. Those that are going to Killeen will be meeting up front following the service tonight. We'll go ahead and close in prayer. If I could have Pastor Evangelist Frankie Chi, if you can close in prayer tonight. Amen. Father,